up for audience comments. Just a reminder that we are not going to be making any decisions tonight. Tonight is about gathering information. So we absolutely want to hear from everyone. So we want to give everybody the opportunity to talk. So we're going to ask the next speaker to come forward. The first speaker is Janice Smith.
Center for School Safety. He talked about his daughter and how her students weren't just her students, they were her kids. And that's so true. Several years ago, several years ago, we had a lockdown situation in Northern, and I don't know if you were there at the time in a classroom, but I was locked in a closet in the library, pitch dark, with 24 crying kids. I had myself between the door and the kids, no air conditioning. At that time, we didn't know it was a false alarm. Something happened at the rock quarry. But that's something any of us who went through that will never, ever forget. You know, kids crying, calling my mommy. Ms. Smith, what's happening? I'm scared. And I was in there thinking, oh, I don't have my cell phone. I want to text my family because I didn't know what was going on. So I've been there. I'm glad we're having this discussion. I want to thank you all for adding the rotating patrol officer to our district. It's definitely an improvement, but I think we should strive for one for every school. As a teacher, I want the community to know that we do have safety plans in place. We know and we practice our safety plans. We're prepared to protect our children the best way we can. But when there's a police car out front of the building, when there is a uniformed officer in the building, it really helps us focus on what we were hired to do, which is educating the children of this community. I didn't go into law enforcement, I went into education. Talking about arming teachers just puts a band-aid on a much bigger problem we have in our schools. And that's what I'm here to talk about. I'm not here to talk about guns, I'm here to talk about kids. Nobody seems to ever ask principals and teachers about the things we deal with on a daily basis. Sometimes we like to put ourselves in a bubble, and we like to think that every family's like ours. You know, a mom, a dad, you know, happy little picture. But that's so untrue. We're seeing an increase in depression, anger, and anxiety, and that's in elementary kids, and that scares me a lot. In 27 years of teaching, I've never addressed a school board before, and that's how important this is to me. I'm worried about our kids. Some kids have way too much free time on their hands. Some kids are way overscheduled. We have students with parents in rehab, jail, or deceased because of overdoses. We've got more grandparents and relatives raising other people's children than I can ever remember. And child neglect is becoming a real problem in our county. We have elementary students who are so emotional, they throw desks and books. They hit and they kick their teacher. Some of them have to even be carried up the hallway away from the rest of the class. Sometimes they're just acting out because of chaos in their lives. Sometimes it's just simply because they were told no, and they're not told no very often. Or they don't know how to lose in a game. But where do our angry elementary students go from Northern and Southern? They go to Sharp. And where do they go from Sharp? They go to Pelham High School and then out into the world. I really strongly feel that society today is so confusing for our kids. They're being exposed to things that children never heard of 20 and 10 years ago. Talk to our counselors, talk to Mr. Compton, who makes the home visits. Talk to your teachers and your principals and get their input before deciding anything. I just really strongly feel that kids need mentors. We don't need to be cutting counselors, we need to be adding counselors. And I feel like the SRO in each school could really be a positive addition to each school's staff. So thank you very much for your time.
The next speaker is Pat Moran.
Thank you for the opportunity to talk to you board members. I'll try to be brief as well. I'd like to address the mental aspect and the training just briefly about this program. I'm very excited about the course program. Just a little bit of background. I'm a school bus driver. I've done that for 25 years. I'm also a father of seven children. I've got three in school. One of them's an elementary teacher, and one of the older ones. So it's near and dear to my heart to protect kids, not only my own, but my students on my bus. And I'm also an airline pilot, retired as of last year. I'm also a federal flight deck officer, retired. So I've been through that program. And I would like to see a similar thing done in the schools. And let me just say right from the start that I'm not a gun guy, and I don't particularly like guns. And if you could take away all the guns in the world, that would be fine with me. But unfortunately, that's not gonna happen. So there's always gonna be guns, there's always gonna be bad guys out there that are using those guns. So what do we do? These presentations, both of them were excellent. And I, after 9/11, we'll back up a little bit more. I'm also military. I've had 12 years active duty and 17 reserve. And the only time I fired a gun, well, twice. One was as a cadet at the Air Force Academy. My first summer there, I got to fire a gun. And then I did some gun qualifications when I flew 141s around the world. And we kept it locked in the flight deck, but we went into a austere location, so I thought we ought to know how to shoot one. But I never owned one, didn't want to. I had minimal training in the Air Force, started flying in the airlines, and then 9/11 happened. And shortly after, I joined the Federal Flight Deck Officer Program. And the main reason I did that is because I'm responsible for 160 people on the back, and I want to make sure they came home on my airplane, and I want to make sure that I came home to my family, as well as the rest of my crew. And I remember in training in Artesia, New Mexico, it was outstanding training, similar to what we're doing here. And the second night I went back to my room, and I can remember it clearly, I lay down and I cried, because for the first time in my life, I thought about taking a gun and shooting somebody and killing them. And I didn't want to do that. It's not something that is in my nature, and I just had to cry it out. And then we had done this sheep and sheepdog training. There's plenty of sheep around that just go through life and don't worry about that. That's the way I was. But there's also the sheepdogs. They have the guns and the uniforms and the badges, and they're the ones protecting us. But they're not always there, and they're not in my cockpit with me. So I thought, I need to go through this training. And the training taught me to have that sheepdog mentality. I'm fully prepared. If somebody busted into my cockpit door and came in there trying to take my airplane, I'm going to blow their heads off. And that's not my nature, but by golly, I had that training and I'm willing and able to do that. They want to come on my bus and do something with my students, I'm going to shoot them if they're there with a gun. And I won't have any hesitation about that. And I don't think if you have a teacher volunteer that volunteers for this and goes through the training, I think they're going to have the same mentality. It changed me dramatically. I own a gun now for self-defense, but I'm still not a gun guy. So mentally, I think I'm able to do that. Training-wise, I think I don't need 6 weeks of police training because I don't need to know how to arrest people. I don't need to know how to put handcuffs on. I don't need to know how to go out of the beat. I don't know how to do anything but protect my cockpit or in the classroom, take a gun out and shoot somebody that's shooting my precious charges. They're there. That's all I need to do. And so I think this training would accomplish that. And just the last comment is, we've never used a gun in a cockpit since 9/11. You know why? Because the terrorists know that a lot of us pilots are armed, thousands of us. They don't know which one. So if they try to blow our cockpit door, which has since been hardened with a cyber lock, They try to blow that and get into that cockpit, chances are somebody's going to be armed and blow them away. And they don't want that. They want the soft target, just like these kids that go into schools and shoot people. What's the first thing they do when armed? People show up. They shoot themselves. Why don't they do that in their own home? Because they want to go into a school and have a big splash and get on the news and kill all these people. But if they know there's armed teachers in that school, I seriously doubt they're going to come, just like they're not coming for us in the cockpit because we're armed. So anyway, I support this program. I hope that you do too, and I would really like to see it. Thank you.
Our next speaker is our Sheriff Craig Peoples.
Good evening, Board. Just wanted some few talking points on the school resource officer program. All police officers, as well as school resource officers, are POP certified police officers by the Department of Criminal Justice Training. We go through 982 hours of law enforcement training. Post is only 6+ days. We assist school administrators dealing with juvenile issues in the school. We're a visible deterrent, as both gentlemen talked about, deterrent. What more of a deterrent can you have than a marked police cruiser sitting out in front of your building and a police officer and dress uniform or uniform visibly? We go through a significant amount of firearms training, use of force. Our agency goes through at least twice a year, and sometimes up to four times a year, remedial training here just through our office, not to include any additional training that my deputies go through at Department of Criminal Justice. We go through the shoot, don't shoot scenarios through the Department of Criminal Justice. CAECO, who is our insurer, they have a fax machine that they will bring to our county for our officers to use, and Todd and I talked about it this evening. I'm sure we can get them to bring that up here, and if to go through the shoot, don't shoot scenarios, as both gentlemen talked about in this computerized simulation, again, if you have teachers that would want to volunteer, or even yourselves, put yourselves in that stressful situation. Watch the TV news program right after a Parkland shooting, and it was an armed school teacher in a non-stressful interview situation. One, he was asked if he had his gun, and he said yes. He pulled that gun out and showed it to the interviewer. You don't do that. Not in that setting. Not in any setting. The second thing that armed teacher did, in a non-stressful situation, he had cowboy boots on, guns down the boot. It took him, it seemed like, 3 to 5 minutes to get that gun out of his boot. So where is a teacher going to hide a gun that can be readily accessible that they're going to be able to get to in a safe manner? NSRO, as Ms. Delaney pointed out, is a great bond with the kids in our schools. They're more open to talk, students are more open to talk to the school resource officer. Elementary kids, they'll come up to you and give you a hug every day. It's a positive role model for them. And I'm going to say it, it allows teachers to be teachers. Teachers are trained to teach, and police are trained to protect. The SRO provides valuable resources to the agencies and other services in the event of a missing or runaway child, as we've experienced today, as over the weekend, and even a few weeks ago. Your school resource officer has access to information through the Infinite Campus program to know where these kids are, provide the road units with phone numbers and addresses that we may not know otherwise. They also are able to, because of their interaction with the kids on a daily basis, they're able to know what kid Johnny's running around with, what kid Susie's running around with. And when we can't find them in any other place, he knows, well, did you check Joe's place? They have that information. That's valuable information that a teacher may not know because you're seeing all the kids different times of the day. And it also provides knowledge to any type of emergency response in the schools. We go through emergency response training here with the schools, all four of them. We've helped put the programs together that we go through now. So we're able to do that. 4 of the last 6 years at least, before Mr. Berkeley left, he and I wrote COPS grants. to provide another school resource officer to our schools. Unfortunately, though, they're so competitive, we were turned down. So we've tried to be proactive in the cost effort and being able to put another school resource officer in here in our school system, but it's just not been favorable in that respect. On the post program, my numbers may not be totally correct. Alabama has 67 counties. There's only one county, based on my information received, that has a school teachers farm program. In Texas, they did not respond back to me, but there's 254 counties. New Hampshire has 10 counties. They have no program, according to the Chiefs and Police Association. South Dakota, they have 66 counties. One county, Minnehaha, I talked to that sheriff personally. I sit on the board with him with the National Sheriff's Association. His county is the only one that has one. And Ohio has 88 counties. Four of those have a program that responded back, 25 do not, so 59 counties did not respond. Of those four counties, Shelby County has at least four school districts that have a program similar to the post, if it's not the post program. And he was very intelligent on this subject and very good to talk to. Defiance County, one school district out of eight. Mercer County, one school district out of seven. And Hardin County, two school districts out of five. So the numbers are not, they're all over the place as to how many teachers are armed in schools across the country. That's my input. Of course, favor the school resource officer program. We started this, I believe, 17 years ago here, but with Tyler Manners, our first school resource officer. And whatever capacity I serve in, I would like to continue that program. Thank you.
Next on the speaker list is Mr. Craig Spaulding.
How y'all doing? This is surprising me. I really didn't know I was going to speak, but.
You're good.
I really am not really up to speed on the program on post. I do know that the SRO program works. We support that. We'll support whatever, we'll do what we have to do to protect kids. That's the bottom line. So whatever you choose to do here, we'll support it. So that's where I stand.
Next is Bob Coutier.
Katana.
You can say
it. Okay, hello board, hello people. My name is Bob Coutier. I came down from Cincinnati. I am the program coordinator for the Center for Hazmat Rescue and Safety at Cincinnati State Technical and Community College. And we had probably the first active killer awareness and safety course in a college campus in the nation. I heard that this, and I want to talk to you, but I also want to talk to everyone, so I'll just kind of face it this way. I heard that you were having this meeting tonight, so I wanted to come down. I know you're gathering information, so I wanted to add some information to the two excellent presentations that I saw. So, and I've been teaching this for quite a while. By the way, my background, I'm a retired military, 18 years active duty, 22 in the Reserve and National Guard. I've been in 9 combat zones since 9/11. I've been wounded twice, so wherever the gentleman is who's been shot at, I've been shot at and shot many times. So I wanted to give you a little bit of background. I have 10 years in law enforcement. I was a SWAT sniper in Hillsborough County Sheriff's Department in Tampa, Florida. And I'm a consultant for Newport Police Department SWAT team right now, especially on active shooter awareness. So we run the active shooter drills at Newport Aquarium and whatnot. I am married. I have an 8-year-old. I'm 58. I have an 8-year-old and an 11-year-old. My wife gave birth at 46 and 48. She works in the Fort Thomas School District, and I have an 8-year-old and 11-year-old in that school district, and that's a soft target. So I have a lot of passion about this. And I want to say one thing up front, and something the sheriff just said, which kind of didn't sit well with me. I don't want folks here to think that Mr. Khalil's program, Post or Faster Saves Lives in Ohio, and I'm not, you know, I didn't like that little questioning about the validity of the numbers, that seemed a little disingenuous, but what I want folks to understand is the Post program or any program with arming people in the schools is not SRO light. It's not a supplement to the SRO program. It's not replacing the SRO program. Because the person carries a concealed firearm doesn't mean they have peace officer status and do police duties in the school. They are another layer, a last layer of defense. Because I don't know about y'all, but I have a God-given, constitutionally protected right to defend myself, which is why we have concealed carry in the Commonwealth. And the question we're all discussing is whether we should have folks in an area that we don't normally allow concealed carry to have concealed weapons. And we are allowed to do it, but not in a school zone, unless it's authorized by the board. But the concept is trying to make it as safe and as practical as possible, not to replace the SRO. I want more SROs. I think that it's invaluable having been in uniform in two different modalities. I think it's important. The concept is not to have SRO light because you're a teacher, an armed teacher. We already talked that it's not just teachers. The concept is to have some people who can use deadly force as a last line of defense or lay down and die in an active shooting bullet. Here's some information I wanted to add to the to both presentations, which were excellent. First of all, the safety and security film. You saw him kicking for an hour and for a minute and 46 seconds. Have you ever installed the safety and security film? Yes. Okay, I have. Let me tell you how it works. Maybe you should watch the video again. When you put the film on the glass and you hit the glass will fall. Solid piece facilitating entry. Go watch the film again. You'll see about a 1-inch black border that goes around the film. So if you are going to install the film, don't just install the film, install the glaze that attaches the film to the frame, or the film will actually facilitate getting through the windows. That's number one. Number two, we talked about there was some mention about hardening the targets, which is excellent, by the way. I think you should actually harden the people, harden the facilities, harden your policies, and then look at your equipment, like having emergency bags with tourniquets, Israeli trauma dressings, chest seals, hemostatic rods, like Mr. Khalil mentioned. Those are the four areas that you want to concentrate on. There's five steps to an active killer incident. The first thing is the person fantasizes, and they almost always communicate that. The second is they plan, and that's where your manifesto comes out. Sometimes they have to be published by the news, or else the person will kill again, if anyone remembers Ted Kaczynski's Unabomber. The third thing is they actually prepare. They start to gather the equipment that they're going to use to perpetrate their crime of violence. The fourth thing is they approach the target, let's say, in this case, the school. And then the fifth thing is the obvious start of killing. You can intervene at any one of those five locations. We're very focused on the last location, but we all have heard in recent times about the person talking that they're going to be the next international school shooter or whatever the term is. So there's a chance to intervene earlier on. But if you get to the last step, the school resource officer having an armed presence right there is a term, having the signs saying that you have armed people, if you do or if you don't, having that sign, you know, from ADT security systems makes the criminal want to rob that house, not the one with the ADT sign. At Cincinnati State on the main campus, we have all the no gun zone signs still up. Where I work in Evendale at the Workforce Development Center, We've taken all our signs down. So we're not telling people this is a victim disarmament zone. This is a killer empowerment zone. We do not have zones, signs saying this is a gun-free zone. Something to think about. In 2013, the FBI Texas State University survey showed that 69% of all active killing situations involving a firearm took place in 5 minutes or less. Now, because I deal with this information and I have a curriculum to share with people, I've trained numerous organizations in and around the greater Cincinnati area, all the way up to New Philadelphia, Ohio, to Springfield, down into northern Kentucky. My last one, I just finished the entire Archdiocese of Cincinnati, the Catholic Church. Something to think about is that the medical training is extremely important, because when you have an active killer situation, it's a crime scene. And I don't know what the protocols are in Pendleton County, but in some places in the United States, it stays a crime scene and they don't let anybody in to triage, treat, and transport the wounded until after the crime scene has been fully vetted and it's safe to enter. Don't know what the situation is, someone else can address it, but I want you to realize if you go in lockdown, like the, one of the young ladies said, it's a pretty scary situation and you feel very helpless. You want to be able to have some skills to mitigate that. Pulse nightclub in Orlando, Florida, 49 people were killed. 24 of them had survivable wounds, but they bled out in the 3 hours between the initial entry and the initial contact with the active shooter, and then the SWAT team made entry. So realize it is a crime scene. So you've got to be able to be self-sustainable. Your safety instructor, by the way, I'm on the SBDMC, the Site-Based Decision-Making Council, for Woodfield Elementary School, and I wrote their safety plan. Or I helped write it with the safety committee. One of the things you want to make sure is that you have go bags. You need to have water. You need to have medical stuff. I mean, not, I don't mean band-aids. I mean bonafide medical equipment. Your folks need to do training in school. Part of your professional development in the summer, you should do that. Ask me. I will train you for free. So, because I teach basic emergency and tactical emergency casualty care, which is the law enforcement equivalent, I also teach it in the military, tactical combat casualty care. I'm a paramedic instructor as well. So if you want that training, I will do it for you for free. So, but again, this is not SRO light. This is allowing responsible people with a high degree of training to not take the place of an SRO, to have an armed response if, God forbid, you need it in the school. And that's it. Thank you for your time.
Our next speaker is Tanya Cummings.
Just to respond to that, first of all, thank you for your service, both. The film, I thought you meant as I put it on. No, I haven't put it on, but you are right. I didn't go over that. It has to be secured when it's put on. That's a great point. You don't just slap it on the glass, it has to be secured. That is taught in our in-service class to all our police officers, so that's a great point. In Kentucky, the crime scene is not a crime scene until the situation is over. So we would not leave a kid injured or people in there to wait for, to keep the evidence secure. Training is going in a direction now. Emergency response, once it's secured, then EMS is taken in with a team to get that first aid there, and then after that, it will become a crime scene. Thank
you. Is that going in that direction, or that's where it is?
That's where we're going right now.
Okay, so it's not there yet.
Well, I can tell you this. I've never stopped a crime scene. I've never stopped dealing with the police situation because of a crime scene. That doesn't happen. We take care of the situations, then the crime scene. I've never been in anything where we said we can't do anything because of a crime scene. In 34 years, I've never stopped to protect. Have you? That's not a concept that we do in Kentucky. I've done it.
So you escort paramedics into a crime scene?
We had paramedics with my SWAT team that went in. Right after we went in, we would bring them in with us.
And are they for the SWAT team, or are they for the kids?
I may have to interrupt this conversation. I would love to be here all night, but I have to. I do appreciate both of you being here. You know that. Tanya, please come forward.
I'm all that.
I know.
So all of it. I think both presentations were awesome, and I think that things can be taken from each presentation. But the thing that I want to stress is don't leave it there. You know, when situations happen, it gets talked about right then, and then never again. And what does that help? Nothing. The situation that we have here, it's been 2 months. I'm not sure what you were told, but it was not handled 100% the way it could have been. Did it happen well? Yes, nobody got hurt. But there were things that could have been done better. Does that mean that anybody was at fault? No. But what I think needs to happen is when we have drills, when we have incidents that happen, debriefings need to happen, and then you need to be transparent. When you go to the meeting, you say exactly what you saw and what could have went wrong, and what are we going to do to fix that then? There needs to be a safety committee. If we don't already have one, if we do, I've been here for almost a year and I don't know about it. I worked at a hospital and there was a safety committee, and we had drills for all kinds of things. And we always debriefed the drills. What went well, what didn't go well, and what are we gonna do to fix what didn't go well? And then we worked on it and we fixed it so that the next time it was fixed and everybody knew it. I would also like to recommend that when we do drills, that not everybody know about it. I also think that drills need to be done during class change. Would it be chaotic? Yes, it would. But everything isn't always going to happen when everybody's in a classroom. And I think that students need to know how to react in a situation that they're not familiar with. And I think teachers need to know that as well. Because you don't know how you're going to act until you're in a situation. And if you practice it, you at least have some idea of what you would do. It makes you think about what you would do so that if you're ever faced with it, you don't freeze. You actually think, okay, this is what I need to do, and you do it. I also think that students who make comments, we have a lot of students who make comments about wanting to shoot this or that or different things. And like they've all said, typically someone who does that has talked about it. And we'd like to think that we're a small community and it would never happen here. But I guarantee you that every school that has had something like that happen also thought, we're a small community, we're close-knit, it would never happen here. When students make comments, I know that a lot of the times, there's nothing to it. But it needs to be looked into and not just a, oh, that's probably not true, or oh, Johnny so-and-so has a bad background at home and we should go easier on him. Johnny so-and-so may have a bad background at home, and I feel bad for that child, but that's even more reason to check out what Johnny so-and-so is saying. So those are just my thoughts. And if we ever start a safety committee, I would do it. I mean, you don't have to be paid for it. I will show up and do a safety committee.
Our last speaker is Shane Morse.
Shane Morris, I grew up here tonight from Berea, and can't help but notice, as last speaker, there seems to be a pattern that we see tonight. It appears that the military guys, and we've been in war now for 17 years, have some advice that we're trying to get across to you from hard work lessons. And then, unfortunately, I've heard some things that seem to be far too common. Civilian law enforcement sometimes. It tends to hold on to dogma that it's fatal and they won't let go of that dogma. Sam and Catherine, God rest his soul, drove from one end of this Commonwealth to the other as head of the Sheriff's Association back in the mid 1990s, warning people of the disaster that concealed carry would be in this state. That didn't come to pass. We've had concealed carry now for 25 plus years. And as you know, we all know, there is not a warp in the time-space continuum over the launch and allow allows people to carry concealed firearms, to mitigate an active shooter, and somehow this could not work in a school setting. And a little background myself, I'm a retired soldier and teacher. I've been trained as a federal law enforcement officer. I've been to the Department of Defense and Protective Service Force. I have been to the Counterterrorism Force. I've conducted protective service missions both here in the continental United States, and I've served on Army Chief of Staff's protection detail in Iraq. So I can tell you from experience that the armed mob, as being proposed by Mr. Cleal, or as is in place in Ohio, and I too did not particularly care for calling into question the statistics, 19 of 50 states are armed school personnel. It might not be every personnel. Mr. Cleal is not talking about that personnel. When the KRS was changed in 2014, that made it possible for myself in the last year I taught to carry concealed every day. Every day for the last year I taught to carry concealed. There was also comments about where you're going to carry. Two of those 5 days a week, I was in a t-shirt and Army concealed PTs. Carried Glock 26 and a spare 17 round backup magazine. It could be done. We still volunteered this time. I drove up from Bria tonight. I'll drive up from Bria as much as you want me. For free to train the personnel. Well, Mr. Cleal's already made it offer. And there are others. There are many of us who would do this. Don't fall for this tired old hope for the best one. I'm telling you, we in this room live another decade. We will see a day in which the armed school personnel law is going to be the standard. Now, I want to put something on you. You will see some of those leadership positions. It's on you. Now, so that you are able to provide the protection as soon as possible, or will it be later, and God forbid, would it be after children's lives are lost, and be made aware of what's available. The picture that I passed, for the audience, and I can see the picture, it's a sign that's on the front of all Kentucky National Guard armories now that states there may be armed personnel at this location. When this was first proposed, just like concealed carry was first proposed in the state, just like when they proposed to arm commercial pilots. That's crazy talk. It can't happen. There's a few blood insurance. There's not. So I would encourage you. Most precious resource for children. And we'll help you make that.
Thank you for all the speakers tonight and for everybody that got up and spoke at the mic. We do appreciate that. Our last thing, we are going to take a break in a few minutes, but I do want to open it up to my board members if they want to say any final thoughts before we close this part of our board meeting. So I'll start down at the end.
And this is our norm for any standard meeting, too, just so you know. I don't think we have many left at this point, but again, congratulations to not only the students that we honored, but also the parents that were here tonight in support of them. We appreciate everything they do and how they represent Pendleton County for us in those competitions. So if some of you in leadership in schools can pass that along, our appreciation for them and all their efforts. Also, an appreciation to each of you all for being with us and listening to the comments. For those that spoke, I want to tell you that we don't leave it there. Quote you. This is the safety of our children is, and we've said it before, it's paramount. A safe and orderly school environment, if you don't have that as a basis, you aren't going to accomplish much. But most of all, they're our kids. They really are our kids and our grandkids. And when you're in the classroom, believe me, and in the school working, there is nothing more precious or more valuable. And you'd lay your life down, and people may not know, but that's, you'd put yourself between them and harm's way just like you would your own. It's instinct from a teacher's heart. So I appreciate, and I appreciate all of our employees for everything they do every day. With that said, I'm going to pass this on down, and by the way, all of you, hang in there. It's going to be a wonderful end of the school year. We've only got a few weeks left. Make the best of them.
I'm not going to say much because literally I'm about brain dead. I don't even know how I'm going to get through the rest of this meeting. I mean, seriously. Lots of really good information, a lot of questions that were answered. Obviously, we're not leaving it here. We are going to, I mean, there's going to be things that are going to have to be put in place. I don't know what that's going to be yet. But there's some things that we need to look at as a school district that I think we've kind of slacked on. Even since my girls have graduated, I think we've slacked. And that's usually when someone attacks, is when you least expect it, or you've slacked somewhere along the line. So it's been a big concern of ours ever since all this has happened. And I, like I said, I really do appreciate the information. I probably can't even make sense of it tonight, but I do really appreciate every teacher that's here tonight and that stayed and listened, because I promise you, they are, and I know how you feel, because people, my own husband would say, I'd say, no, not my real kids, my kids, and he's like, wait a minute, you only got real kids. I'm like, no, my classroom kids are my kids too, and I meant that. I mean, I meant it, and if another teacher yelled at him, I could yell at him. But you better not let Janet come over and say, Miss Griffin, no, they're my kids. I'll take care of them. I mean, and that's the truth. That's how you get, okay? And so you guys staying has meant the world to me, to look out and see your faces, and I know you really care. I will say that I heard that the high school conducted a situational awareness, I guess, or whatever, as they were doing a class change. And perfect, because that guy pulled the fire alarm, and where'd those kids go? They went to the hallway. They were setting ducks. They had nowhere to go. So kids need to be aware of that situation, regardless of if we have armed teachers or not. They need to know how to protect themselves and where to go. And I don't want, in 5 years, I'm going to have a grandbaby at Northern Elementary, and I don't want to tell them that somebody's going to come in and try to shoot at them, that a murderer. But you know what? It's reality today. We can't baby them. So, anyway, I appreciate all you guys do, and I'm probably not going to be able to get through much of the meeting tonight, so if I make a vote that's not good, just ignore it.
I really can't add much more to what you two just said, but I want to thank everybody who came out. It's just amazing how much support we have on both sides. So it's going to be something we're really going to think about here. I want to also thank Mark and Joe for the presentations and everybody who got up to speak. So thanks for coming out. I appreciate it.
Change, and I do think that's something that needs to be implemented more, and it was an excellent idea, and it was executed very well for, as far as I can see. It really did scare everybody, as far as I knew, and honestly, my thought was, I hope this isn't real, but I think it might be, holding my textbook over my heart, and I'm just praying. So it really was an excellent drill, and I think it was very well executed, and I want to say props to all of our administrators for carrying that out, and yeah.
Thank you, and thank you all for coming too. Our county has not been immune to teen suicide, runaways. We've seen a lot of runaway kids lately, at least I have on Facebook. I don't know if it's real, I think it is, but we haven't been immune to those kind of things, and certainly probably aren't going to be immune to a potential active shooter, and so anything we can do to prevent that, and I appreciate the presentations that we heard. the school resource officer, I think, is critical. I think ultimately we're still talking about putting guns and someone with weapons in the school, and we want to make sure that they have the wherewithal to use them and know when and how to use them as well. So, I'm going to call you Mr. C, if you don't mind, but thank you for coming and thank you for your service, as well as you, Mr. Morris. Thank you for coming. Mr. Morris, thank you for coming as well. I don't know how you heard about our meeting, or maybe you read it online, I don't know, but I appreciate your interest, and it is something that's near and dear to me. I know a couple of months ago I received a text from my daughter that they were on lockdown. And of course I'm texting back right away, because there's a feeling that it's indescribable when your child could be in harm's way. And I would die for her right now. And it's, I'm sorry, I don't think I can continue, but I think you know what I mean. And this is really, really important. And whether it's teachers having guns or staff having guns, again, these are people that are going to volunteer. That's not something you wish to do. We're certainly not going to force anyone, I don't think. And I'm not saying that I'm for this program or not. I think we still need, there's a lot of things we still need to look into, but I just can't say I am very passionate about at least doing what we can do for our kids.
All right, I'll make this short, I promise. I typed this up last night because I knew we were going to be here late, and I know how I get about this time. I get really like gibberishy, and I was afraid I wouldn't get my thoughts completely right, so I typed it up at midnight last night. So I do want to mention that I have been a practicing nurse for 3 years. Actually, this coming month I'll be 3 years. And I know I don't show my age, do I? When patients enter our hospital, our number one goal is keeping them safe. We use multiple strategies to keep patients safe. Bedside rounding, timeouts, two patient identifiers, we're giving medications. Same thing that Tony was talking about. We do multiple things to keep our patients safe. Much like caring for patients, our number one goal for our students when they enter our schools is keeping them safe. I believe to adequately protect our students, we must use a multi-layered approach to protect them. As much as I would love to have an SRO in every building, I know our budget cannot support that. Guys, I'm very familiar with our budget, and it cannot. We cannot do that. When Boone County recently placed an SRO in every building, in every school, it's my understanding at least, that one certified and one classified position was eliminated at each school. Even if our budget could afford it, I don't think it's the best way to mitigate the threat. Having the combination of two programs, SROs and the postgrad program, is better because it's much more like the airline industry does with the armed pilots and air marshals. A program can only be successful if it is implemented correctly. Successful implementation requires collaboration between administration, the SROs, and participants in the POST program. And I want to highlight what the word I highlight is on my paper. The key word is collaboration. Ultimately, the relationships students build with other students and staff are the foundation of school safety. Our board must continue to examine preventive efforts such as mental health screening, counseling, and bullying prevention to reduce student violence. And I am going to reach out, I already have, to Dr. Tina Robbins. I didn't invite her to this meeting because I never knew we were going to dealing with the threat. The other thing we had to look at is prevention. And she did, I will speak with her and I'll have her at another meeting. So that's another thing, another part of that equation that we need to look at. The challenge for our board is to figure out how to best protect our students and staff while limiting the financial impact on all the other services that our schools provide for our students in our community. I do want to thank every one of you for being here tonight, because really the success of our schools really depends on each and every one of you, because you're the ones that elect us and put us in. thank you for being here tonight. Thank you for not walking out when we took that 10-minute break. And just thank you so much for just being here tonight. Thank you.
I know that this is my reports upstairs, but I'm going to add some comments tonight for the group for this part. I'm sure most of you are not going to come upstairs with us when we finish the meeting. I also would like to thank Mr. Khalil and Mr. Philburn for the presentations. I've heard Mr. Khalil's several years ago, and I think he modified it and changed it a little bit. And while I've never met Mr. Philburn till tonight, I've heard the program through the Center for School Safety before, so I'm familiar with that. So I've heard most of what was presented tonight. As I stated earlier, I think it's important for the audience, and we lost, I think, about half of our group that separated, but we're glad those of you that stayed because it's important. And I think the thing that I wanted to say about our current operation, current procedure, and so that you know that, you know, with our incident that happened at the middle school back in the spring, you know, a lot of parents posted messages, you know, we need to know what's going on. We need to know your procedures. We need to know what happens in lockdown. You need to post that on the website. And I'm like, no, you don't, because you don't want the people that would potentially come to the school to do something to have access to your process and procedures. So there are a lot of things that go on. For those of you that are parents and those who are teachers, know this, there are a lot of procedures. There's a lot of processes. There's a lot of drills that take place that the average public doesn't see. The school administrators are constantly involved with that. District staff's involved with that. You know, our SRO and the sheriff's office is involved in that. And, you know, since that incident in middle school, I want to thank members of the fiscal court and the sheriff's office for working with us, getting that measure of security. And also the chief of Falmouth and Butler, because during that time, he talked to their mayors, and they've added an additional presence at the elementary school, two elementaries just to be there. So there's a lot of those things that go on behind the scenes that people in the community, parents don't realize, that maybe sometimes the board, you know, doesn't realize all the things that go on. So, yeah, I just want you to realize that, you know, when I made my comments at the beginning, that the safety of our schools and our students and our staff is of most importance for me. And for those of you that know, I started my career teaching agriculture and did that for 10 years before I got into administration. George Strait started his career as an ag teacher before he got into country music. And as George made his farewell tour a couple of years ago, I'm making my farewell tour the next 2 months before I retire. So I say that to make the point is that, as Dr. Nordheim said, we as a community elect a board to represent us. So tonight, some of you may not have spoken, expressed your concerns, your likes, your dislikes. As a superintendent and soon to be voter in the school board district, I would encourage you to share with your board members through email or phone calls or whatever, and let them know how you feel. One way or another, how you feel. I mean, I'm not saying one stance or another. I mean, I think most people that know me kind of know how I feel, but, you know, not bringing that into the discussion, I think it's important that you communicate to your board members, because that's the only way they know. You know, I mean, I can tell them what I hear and think. Other people, administrators, can say that. But, you know, they need to hear from you. So, you know, I would encourage you to take that opportunity, you know, between now and time. Of course, I think, Mr. DeMarcus, I mean, for us to do any kind of change would be a board policy change, I think, which would mean that there'd be a couple of readings in that. And I'm sure, you know, as the board moves through that process, there'd be an opportunity to share information and that kind of stuff. So I would encourage you, you know, as Dr. Nordheim said, there's no decisions being made tonight. I'm sure we'll have discussions in the future before I'm gone. And then when the new superintendent comes, I'm sure that he or she will be involved in that discussion. So just to encourage you to do that. Again, thank you all for coming. I guess Dr. Nordheim, we're ready to recess and move upstairs. Okay, so thank you for coming.